peace caravan to Cuba, which every year delivers hundreds of tons of humanitarian aid and U.S. citizens to Cuba, both in defiance of the U.S. blockade on Cuba and the travel ban. A cruel, immoral, and unjust policy. For over 50 years, the U.S. has continued their blockade, has continued to deny the people of Cuba access to basic goods, like rice from Alabama, like medical supplies that contain even 50% U.S. components, pharmaceuticals that are patented in the United States and sourced from the United States. All of these things are banned to be traded with Cuba by the U.S. government as part of this blockade, a blockade that has cost Cuba $1.2 trillion. But we are here today with our van full of humanitarian aid, education supplies, sports equipment, and medical supplies to be delivered to Cuba through this very border crossing here at Peace Arch Park in between Vancouver, British Columbia, and Blaine, Washington. We are here to break the U.S. blockade on Cuba, which every year has been successfully broken by the unity and solidarity of people across Canada, the United States, Mexico, and Cuba. We're going to lift the U.S. blockade on Cuba today. We are not going away until our humanitarian aid has crossed through this very border. We are going to stand with the people of Cuba, with the people of the United States, with the people of Canada, all foreign oppressed people around the world, in demanding a unified voice, an end to this cruel, immoral, and unjust policy of a U.S. blockade against Cuba. If there's a law against loving our neighbor, we want to break it. But while the United States government has a blockade against Cuba, Cuba does not have a blockade against the United States. Despite the fact that the United States makes it so difficult for Cuba to access basic medicine, Cuba not only still provides free health care to its citizens, but it also sends doctors around the world to disaster zones, to impoverished areas, to help people with their doctors and also to train new doctors. And not only that, but Cuba has a school, a Latin American school of medicine in Cuba, where despite the fact that the United States has a blockade on Cuba, Cuba opens those doors of that school to people in the United States. Here with us today, we have a graduate of the Latin American School of Medicine, someone who graduated as a doctor in Cuba for free, and she is from the United States. The United States now has a doctor that, thanks to Cuba, is trained to help people and is now helping in impoverished areas in the United States. That's the kind of solidarity and internationalism that Cuba provides not only to its people but to the world. And without the blockade on Cuba that we are trying so hard to lift, Cuba will be able to do that even more. So that's why we're here today demanding that this van of humanitarian aid be allowed to cross into the United States on its way to Cuba, and to demand that for once and for all, the blockade be lifted completely and entirely from Cuba.
This is a very important thing, is that a lot of people, because they heard that the U.S. and Cuba are reestablishing diplomatic ties, that this is an end to the U.S. government's hostility towards Cuba. Unfortunately, that's not true. In fact, the United States has continued to implement the blockade by penalizing international banks who have been dealing with the Cuban government. Since December, at least 3 international banks have been penalized for doing business with the government of Cuba. We know that there are still travel restrictions on Americans who want to travel freely to Cuba. Yes, some things have been lightened or changed. It's easier to get an educational visa to travel to Cuba, but this is not a full lifting of the travel ban. Americans cannot travel to Cuba in the same way that they can travel to hundreds of countries around the world. The other issue, of course, for Cuba is Guantanamo Bay. We know that one of the only places in Cuba where torture is allowed is happening under the nose of the U.S. government in Guantanamo Bay, in their prison camp and also on their military base. And for over 50 years since the triumph of the Cuban Revolution, the government of Cuba has been demanding that the United States government leave the military base and close its prison in Guantanamo Bay. And so this is another big part of this reestablishment of relations does not mean that the U.S. is leaving Guantanamo, and this is something else that we have to continue to work for. Why are we so opposed to this blockade? The U.S. blockade on Cuba over the last 50 years has prevented over $1 trillion worth of economic trade and commerce between Cuba and other countries, especially with the United States. It has meant that Cubans haven't been able to properly equip their medical system, equip their schools, build roads, build homes, and build so many other things that are a part of their socialist vision for the world, to make things more equal for people in their country. And the U.S. government has done this under the guise of penalizing the Cuban government, saying that this is a quote-unquote dictatorship that they can't support. But we know that the thing, under any sanctions, but especially under this blockade, the people that are suffering is not just the Cuban government and its projects, but it's also the Cuban people. And this is one of the reasons that we have been involved in this caravan, myself since 2005, many people here since the very beginning, in supporting these amazing caravans to Cuba, which are a gesture of friendship from the American people to the Cuban people, saying that we are neighbors, we are friends, we have a common battle against the empire, and we are going to wage it together against this blockade. And so we're here today as really a part of a new history, because we're going to go to that border today with a van full of humanitarian aid. It's going to have Cuban flags on it, signs saying Viva Cuba on it, and we're going to declare we're taking this aid to Cuba. 3 years ago, they decided to put a big roadblock in our border crossing. They chose to tell us that we needed to go to the truck cross, which is about 8 kilometers away, about 5 miles, and they held the aid there and came up with a bunch of reasons that they weren't going to let the aid through. First telling us that they thought it was commercial goods, then later telling us that they would let most of the aid through, but not the sports equipment. They tried to tell us that sports equipment was not humanitarian aid. And we said, no, it is all humanitarian aid. We've been sending sports equipment for the last 20 years. There's no new laws prohibiting basketballs for Cuban children. We are going to stay here overnight at the border, and we're going to try coming through the border again tomorrow morning with media cameras, with journalists, and we'll see what you have to say then. And so we did. We occupied the border. We stayed overnight. We set up a tent. We sent press releases. And the next morning when we tried to cross the border again, we had 6 TV cameras with us. And guess what? All of a sudden, the sports equipment could probably be filed under educational supplies, couldn't it? All right, I guess we'll let you through with all of it. So that was a huge victory. Thank you. That many of us here were a part of winning. And that tenacity, that spirit of standing our ground, of not letting them divide our aid, not letting them divide us, but really standing together against this blockade is exactly what Reverend Lucius Walker stood for, is exactly what our dear friend Tom Warner stood for. And these are two important people that we've lost over the past few years, who were really key to this caravan.
It was in the 1990s, mid-1990s, when I was here being involved with the caravan, not as a participant directly, but as a supporter. And it was right here in the same spot where I came several times. That was the same time when I met Lucius Walker and Corriere, who was the president of ECAP, at the time. Anyway, so to me, this is sort of brings back some good memories of this action. It has been mentioned, Lucius Walker and Tom Warner, but I am sure that if they could see us here today, they would be so proud of us, and they would really give us a strong applause. But I am sure that they are here in spirit today, and that has been mentioned. I'm confident of that. So, of course, December 17, 2014, that is sort of a date that we will all remember for a long time. Cuba will remember it, and we will remember it. We'll probably do some actions to commemorate that date. Now, the date is important because, first of all, the last three of the Cuban five were freed on that day. Now, that alone is sort of emotional for us, and we are happy that happened. So now all the Cuban five are back home, and in fact, not only that, they are traveling all over the world now, meeting with friends, the friends that they have supported them, the friends that have contributed to their freedom. Fernando, in fact, was here in Canada, in Toronto, just a few weeks ago. So they're in their visits, they're giving thanks to all these solidarity groups, all these people who have helped them. And I say we should thank them. I think we should thank them because they have taught us how to be in solidarity, how to be united, how to be strong. They have taught us what the unconditional commitment to social justice is, as well as how to resist a powerful U.S. government with dignity. Okay? That's what we learned. That's at least what I learned from them. So that has been a great event on December 17th. But of course, December 17th was also the announcement of reestablishing a political, diplomatic relationship between the United States and Cuba. Now, I think it has been mentioned already, so I'm just quickly reminding us that the important statement about that announcement is basically the recognition that the U.S. government foreign policy with Cuba has totally failed. Yep. Totally failed. We knew that. I mean, we know that all along. But I think that has been sort of a confirmation that comes from high up, Barack Obama himself. But we also know now, and we should be aware, that the aspirations, the U.S. aspirations of domination, U.S. aspirations of interventionism in Cuba, that is not over yet. That is still alive, and that's where we need to be very alert. Now, how do we know that? Why do we know that this sort of the control or domination is still there? Well, I think Obama himself has told us. And I want to quote some things because I always like to quote those who the same words that people say. In reference to the blockade and other sanctions against Cuba during more than 50 years, Obama said on December 17th, and I quote, "No other nation joins us in imposing these sanctions." He said that. And yet, it does not get the message yet. So then he concludes, it's time for a new approach. Okay, now, what is this approach? What is this approach? Okay, again, Obama is telling us. We don't even have to guess that much. Later in his declaration, after the December 17, his declaration to Reuters, he said, and I quote again, "We need to try something new that encourages and ultimately forces the Cuban government to engage in a modern economy," end quote. So now pay attention to that phrase. It's very, very powerful. If I mean, you can read it and just dismiss it, but it's extremely powerful, it's extremely important. First of all, as mentioned, let me start from the least important one, which is, you know, the modern economy. Well, Cuba has been working on that since 2011 or before then. They've been trying to modernize their economy, and they are succeeding at that. They are progressing on that. They are working hard at doing that. I don't think that what Obama means by modern economy is probably maybe a capitalist economy. That's what maybe he's thinking. But what strikes me the most is the phrasing policies that ultimately forces the Cuban government. Now, when in his address, December 17th, Obama has spoken to the people of Cuba, not to the government. Now, this is diplomatic relationship, government to government, but he's speaking to the Cuban people. He's not speaking to the Cuban government. And interestingly, the only time that he refers to the Cuban government is right here, when he says, to force the Cuban government. I mean, that is really amazing, and that is really striking. We have to pay attention to that. How do you force a government? What rights do you have to force a government? That's extremely important. Obama's words, not mine. So I ask, you know, how is it different? How is this new policy now different from the last ones over the last 50 years? Well, my answer to that is using different tactics, but the goal remains the same. That's all we can infer from that. And then there is a sense of arrogance also in his declaration of December 17th. I said he addressed the people mostly. Well, here he is, and I quote again, to the Cuban people, talking to them, right? We believe that you should be empowered to live with dignity and self-determination. I mean, yeah, I see somebody laughing. I laugh at that. It's ridiculous. And I get angry too, though. It's ridiculous. I mean, like, you know, the Cuban Revolution has been working very, very hard to give dignity to the Cuban people. The Cuban Revolution has worked very, very hard to preserve, in fact, the self-determination as a sovereign country against the U.S. interference. All of this Cuba has been doing for many, many years, since before Obama was born. And yet, that's what he says. The Secretary Roberta Jacobson, she is the U.S. rep in the discussions, again, and I quote her now, because she's part of that establishment. We want to try and go directly to the Cuban people. I believe that we also will get some things that matter in opening our embassy and hopefully the ability to travel throughout the country and see more people and support more people. Again, it's very clear out there. That's the intention of opening the embassy in Havana, no other, okay? Of course, now, this, I don't know if you heard, but this just happened over 2 weeks ago. The U.S. Senate has approved $30 million requested by the State Department for, I quote, programs to promote democracy and strengthen civil society in Cuba. Okay? I mean, a government could not be more consistent than this. So basically, what I read from all of this is only to increase the ideological and political subversion against the Cuban Revolution. And how are they doing it? How will they try to achieve this? By splitting the people from the government. Cuba, the strength of Cuba is they are united. People and government, they're not separate entities. They are together, they are united, they are in solidarity. But what's going to happen, and the United States knows this, they would try to separate them, try to divide them. So they talk to the Cuban people, they will infiltrate the Cuban people, so they will rebel and they will oppose the Cuban government. And I think that is the danger. That is what they will try to do. Mind you, this is not new. They've been doing this in other countries. We know that, right? Okay, so let me, I want to, maybe I don't want to take too much time, as I said. So what can we say about Cuba's future and challenges? I will say what I see. For instance, on the positive side of things, okay? I see a Cuba that has endured a tragic special period and long special period. And in fact, what has made them survive the special period, as I mentioned already, has been because they've been united. All of Cuba has been united. When I say united, I'm not saying 100%, just in case somebody's saying, no, but I know there are opposition, there's opposition there. Of course there is. But what we're talking about is the bulk of the people. We're talking about the majority of the people. We're talking about a people who's determined to self-determination, a people who has chosen their government, and that's what they are supporting. So I see Cuba as being very strong, actually. Cuba is a strong. They have a long memory of U.S. interventionism, and I think they don't like that, and I think they are against that. They are quite aware of that, and therefore I see that as a strength. In fact, just last February when I was there and I spoke to many different people, that was exactly the message that I was getting from Cubans. So also on the positive side, what's happening now in Cuba with the new economic model, I think that's very positive and it's very constructive. They think ahead. Cubans always have had this way of knowing what they need and they work at it and they move fast on it. And they do it, they discuss it, and they go ahead with it. So I think this is a very constructive step that Cuba has taken. So this is not a time to question Cuba on what they are doing. This is a time to question the U.S. policy against Cuba. And we have to be consistent, we have to be solid on that. Now on the challenging, The U.S. nowadays, the way I see it, has a very unique opportunity to start afresh. If the U.S. government just wanted it and thought of it, they could start a new, fresh relationship with Cuba. This is the opportunity now. Really, truly friendship, respectful relationship with Cuba. Respectful of their dignity, respectful of their sovereignty, respectful of their self-determination. That's all they needed to do. You know what? In turn, all of Latin America would notice that and would applaud that. So the U.S. would have this opportunity. Will they take it? Now, on the challenges side of this new sort of establishment of relationship, I see a U.S. determined to destabilize the Cuban government. As I said, they will try to do it by dividing the people from the government. I see a U.S. that is guided by its doctrine of American exceptionalism, and I always mention that, always will refer to that, and because this is written all over the approach in foreign policy. As someone said, habits of power are not readily relinquished. So it's going to be very difficult for the U.S. to relinquish the doctrine of American exceptionalism. And I see also, now, if you think the blockade is not over yet, and the blockade will not, and is not about to end yet. Now, if you think reestablishing diplomatic relationships, opening the doors to the U.S. to actually get closer to the Cubans, okay, and therefore trying to have more influence. And if you think of the blockade still being in place, Think of the consequences of those two events taking place at the same time. So the blockade is not there to end yet. I don't think that will disappear over time. We know politically, whatever, we know it's a legislation and only Congress can do that. But Obama can also do quite more to be able to end that. So to conclude, the great divide between U.S. and Cuba and Canada and Cuba, notice I haven't spoken much about Canada, but we're all there, isn't the way they practice foreign policy, okay? Cuba has a tradition of solidarity in their foreign policy. We all know the medical missions and so on and so forth. The U.S. has a tradition, as also has been mentioned, of division and domination. Now, the Canadian foreign policy is a wishy-washy, up and down, one day is better than another day, and depending on how the prime minister wakes up that day, or who knows what, but it has been a roller coaster. So I think that will continue being so. Will continue being so. It has gotten worse recently with this very conservative Harper government, which we hope will end soon. Opening the embassies in Washington and Havana is a necessary diplomatic step, but only a change in U.S. foreign policy will actually bring peace, and that we have to always remember. So what we need is basically a paradigm shift from being in solidarity to practicing solidarity. So today, we are practicing solidarity, all of us, okay? Let's keep that in mind. We're good practitioners, okay? So I will not go over now what needs to be done. I think Tamara has already mentioned some of the actions. Guantanamo has to be returned. I would add to that the lay of adjustment, Cuban Adjustment Act, that has to be done away. That's still in place. Can you believe that? So some other more work needs to be done. And we know how to do it. We've been working at this for many, many years, so we know how to do it. We have been able collectively to achieve the freedom of the Cuban Five. So we know how to work together. And we know what working together means. So all we have to do is continue with that same spirit. So, but today, we break the blockade of Cuba, okay? Yay, let's go for it, let's go. Thank you.
Okay, so I wanted to ask you a follow-up question about your talk. And you were talking in there about Obama, you know, saying that his strategy is to promote democracy in Cuba. And so, you know, in the light of US history, some people might actually think the United States is a democracy. But that sounds good, you know, promote democracy. What does that actually mean, though, in U.S. foreign policy?
Excellent.
Well, I think democracy has been devalued in its meaning. The notion of democracy, I mean, has totally been lost. And I think now, if we really wanted to interpret the meaning of democracy in the way that Obama or the United States government wants to promote it, it's more like a free market, maybe, a capitalism. It has an ideological notion to it. Now, democracy, originally, if you want to go back to the Greeks, or if you want to sort of reinterpret it today, I mean, it doesn't have an ideology behind it. Yeah. Democracy is the government of the people. I mean, that's the origin of it. I don't see that would have changed today. But of course, the self-interest of the U.S., or the U.S. government, the promotion of their own ideology has totally changed the meaning of democracy. So, you know, we have to be aware of that. We can't just say the word and believe that it is what it is. Depends who talks about it, and when it comes from the U.S. government, I think we have to take that with a little bit of salt and and understand the real meaning behind it.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
So I see you guys got through the border in half an hour or something?
Yeah, less than that. Probably a record time for getting across the border on this part of the leg anyways.
Huh. So what did they do?
They came and they questioned us. They asked what we had in the van, where we were going, what we were doing. And we told them we had a van full of humanitarian aid on its way to Cuba. There was some humming and some hawing, but they took the manifest of the aid and they asked us what we had, and we said we have wheelchairs, we have walkers, we have sports equipment for kids, we have notebooks for kids. They looked at that, and finally they let us through.
They didn't search you?
They took our keys and looked through, I think, but it's pretty obvious what's in here. We gave them exactly the information they needed. It's all wheelchairs and humanitarian aid. There's nothing else.
Why do you think they didn't make you wait 24 hours like they did before?
Well, I'm hopeful that it's part of this new U.S.-Cuba relations that finally the United States has realized how isolated it is on its policy on Cuba. The blockade on Cuba has been inhumane and immoral and outdated since the day that it began. And this is part of the process of breaking down the blockade, that the political will in the United States is becoming smaller and smaller to maintain the blockade on Cuba.
Oh, okay. Well, thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Well, I wrote this. It's kind of long, so... okay. My father's life and death have been primary motivating factors in my choice of medicine as my life's work. He was an African-American software engineer and veteran community activist from the city of Detroit, Michigan. As a single father, he raised my brother and I in a multicultural environment in Los Angeles that was predominantly Spanish-speaking, and he taught us to appreciate the variations among cultures and the importance of work that is dedicated to the full flourishing of all people. One lesson I recall in particular in his appreciation for the positive outcomes of the Cuban Revolution, particularly in the areas of healthcare and education. I am half Mexican and half African American, and my family, my younger brother, my father, and I lived together in Los Angeles until my father's untimely passing on November 14, 2004. At that time, my younger brother and I were partly through our studies at UCLA, and our family was forced to survive on student loans and scholarships because my father was ill and had been unemployed for 2 years. Although he had over 40 years experience in his field, he could not escape the vast unemployment that was affecting many Americans at the time. Then he was told he had aggressive tumor growth in his lung, and 2 months later, he was diagnosed with stage 4 adenocarcinoma of the lung. It was a devastating time for all of us, and as the eldest child of my father and my father's main support, I was responsible for making critical decisions about his care, filling out paperwork, and figuring out how to pay his medical expenses. I spent countless nights at his bedside, having to go to school the next day, and also trying to help my younger brother cope. Over this period of time, I realized some of the inequities of our U.S. medical system. Since his health coverage at the time was minimal, he was denied access to various cancer treatments. His doctors advised me to apply to coverage through the veterans' health benefits after he was diagnosed as a way to receive more serious treatment. But by the time the paperwork was processed, it was too late. Observing these delaying priorities firsthand, seeing cost made more important than my father's urgent health care need was a devastating blow for me. I came face to face with the challenges that the healthcare system presents to underserved individuals and families. It was after losing my father that my interest in medicine solidified, and I became focused on learning more about treatments, origins, and methods of preventative medicine that could ensure that low-income people who need medical healthcare and access to doctors who cared for them. I became aware that my family's situation was not uncommon, and that what we had experienced was a phenomenon affecting low-income families nationwide. My father loved his people, and as a community activist, he had worked over 30 years in the Detroit area with the aim of eliminating poverty. Growing up with him, I learned this conviction of helping poor communities because of the knowledge and experience my father had shared. When he passed away, I became determined to obtain an education to help my community. This was the beginning of my dream of becoming a medical doctor and contributing in this way to underserved communities. Without family and financial support, applying to medical schools in the United States is too often an insurmountable goal. So doing an internet search, I discovered La Escuela Latinoamericana de Medicina, a program in Cuba. And I applied to the school soon after graduating from UCLA. And I was accepted in the entering class of 2008. Being a student at ELAM was a life-changing experience that served to solidify my interest in primary patient care that uses a humanitarian approach to prioritizing need over cost. I learned medicine in a system where patients are attended at no cost, according to their needs. In addition to my medical studies, I volunteered at Cuban hospitals and research institutions, including El Instituto Nacional de Oncología y Radiobiología de Cuba, where I participated as a volunteer in the Sala de Pediatría. I also participated as a student researcher at the Center of Immunology for 3 years of my medical training. This laboratory focuses on the applications of mathematical modeling in the immune system, including the design of new therapies against cancer. This research experience involved learning immunology, biochemistry, and basic skills in mathematical modeling that are very critical. I also received training in the principal laboratory techniques employed in cellular immunology. During summer 2011, as part of a student foreign medical volunteer group called the Brigada Médico Estudiantil, I learned the opportunity to work with underserved people in a small community in Oaxaca, Mexico. We offered free medical health care and medications to help the community of Huautla de Jiménez in Oaxaca. Huautla is an indigenous community on the north side of the state of Oaxaca and is one of 100 communities with the highest marginalization and poverty rates in Mexico. It was an impactful experience for me since it was the first time that I was using my medical knowledge outside of Cuba for a purely humanitarian effort. We work for 3 weeks, 8 to 12 hours per day, and I thoroughly immersed myself in helping and learning from this indigenous community. Serving some patients who had never seen a doctor in their lives due to lack of trust as well as lack of finances or insured medical coverage. Part of our project was also to complete an analysis of health, employing methods from Cuba's primary healthcare system to study 372 families for the development of plans and strategies to prevent disease and promote health in this area. We conducted direct interviews with families in the community by realizing a pesquisa or inquiry format similar to our dengue campaigns in Cuba. We climbed hills to reach distant homes accompanied by translators to translate the community's native Mazateco to Spanish. And we compiled a first-hand review of the population's current health situation with the aim of reducing the incidence of the most prevalent diseases in this population. Seeing the impact of our small group of medical students in this community cemented my desire to continue working with underserved communities in my life's work as a doctor. After my experience with the community of Huautla, I had a newfound appreciation for Cuba's medical system of universal free health care, and I avidly took advantage of all the opportunities to enhance my clinical experience. In the Cuban system, family medicine doctors realize primary preventative care for the entire population. If a patient needs an x-ray, blood test, or more specialized treatment, they are referred to the neighborhood policlinico or polyclinic. There is one polyclinic for every 25,000 people, and a patient that needs more serious treatment like surgery or chemotherapy gets referred from the polyclinic to a hospital. In Cuba, there are more than 265 hospitals with approximately 70,424 beds, or one bed per every 159 inhabitants. This is in contrast to here in the U.S., where many uninsured patients get their only care in hospital emergency rooms. The universal primary care in Cuba helps to decrease the number of patients who need to be admitted to hospitals, in addition to the fact that all healthcare services in Cuba are free of charge, meaning that patients need no insurance and no co-payments. Cubans pay for outpatient prescriptions, hearing aids, eyeglasses, crutches, canes, walkers, and dental and orthopedic prosthesis, where prices are in Cuban pesos, are also subsidized to stay low, and there's also financial aid for lower income people. During my internship or final year at the Hospital Universitario Calixto Garcia Iñiguez in La Habana, I developed a strong interest in family and internal medicine. I rotated through various specialties, learning to be almost completely responsible for my patients while conducting physical exams, clinical histories, differential diagnosis, and clinical procedures on a daily basis. I also had the experience of learning from some of the best doctors in Cuba who taught and supervised me directly. As an intern, I became accustomed to receiving up to 80 patients during a weekly 24-hour shift and indicated treatment for each patient. I attended patients with a range of uncompensated chronic diseases to medical emergencies. During the fifth year of medical school, we also participated in a nationwide dengue campaign, as mentioned previously, where we learned the principles of preventative health care in the communities near La Habana, going to people's homes, performing physical exams, and household health inspections, and giving frequent charlas or talks on this infectious disease. These experiences contributed greatly to my ability to treat patients in the hospital and community setting. In sum, then I feel I have received an extraordinary medical education in Cuba, and I look forward to a lifetime of using my education in the service of underserved communities. Going forward, my immediate plan is to continue my education by entering a U.S. residency program in family medicine. My areas of interest for future work as a medical doctor include the goal of contributing to cancer research and the goal of repaying the communities that have helped ground my formation. This includes the community I grew up in. I have been heavily influenced by the supportive Mexican immigrant community of Los Angeles, where the impact of immigration has created a large population of people without access to adequate health care. This also includes the significantly African American community of my father's hometown in Detroit, Michigan, which experiences one of the highest poverty and unemployment rates in the nation. I do not exclude the possibility of working in any other part of the country, as the need for healthcare professionals is a nationwide problem. Nor do I exclude periods of time working abroad, particularly in the indigenous communities of Mexico, such as the indigenous people of Huautla, where I learned there is a great need for good doctors. With the recently implemented Affordable Care Act, people are still left out of access to medical care. Today in 2015, there are approximately 26 million Americans without health insurance. Millions of Americans don't get coverage due to unemployment, making too much money for Medicaid, or expensive deductibles before receiving Obamacare coverage. Local migrant clinics pressure physicians to evaluate patients within a 10 to 15 minute appointment due to the current healthcare system and its financing. I have learned that migrant clinic charges often are based on a sliding scale, having to pay $15 copay for each visit or more when migrant workers earn way below the minimum wage at times. Undocumented migrants do not qualify for Medicaid or Medicare due to their immigrant status. How many people in the U.S. die from preventable diseases with third world statistics in a first world country? Currently, I am a volunteer doctor at the Union Gospel Free Clinic that has been wonderfully created to help the underserved community of Yakima. This wonderful team of volunteer doctors, nurses, and specialists attends over 12,000 patients yearly. I work with doctors that have become tired of for-profit medicine and have regained their humanity after voluntarily leaving their previously high-paying jobs to serve a great need, like Dr. Ryan Crafts. 99% of the patients we receive do not have medical insurance, as they are undocumented Mexican agricultural workers that have been migrating to the Yakima Valley for years. Many are also the homeless that live at the mission or under nearby bridges, and working poor Americans that can't afford insurance, co-pays, and expensive deductibles. Why are the immigrants here? In 1994, U.S. President George W. Bush, along with Mexican President Carlos Salinas, signed a North American Free Trade Agreement, which expanded competition beyond the border of Mexico and left many Mexican farm workers bankrupt, over 2.3 million farm workers jobless, after being forced to compete with the massive core crop businesses of the Midwest that receive large government subsidies. This is one of the many factors created by our government that forces workers from other countries to migrate here in the hopes of making a tolerable living. The agricultural industry is still neglecting them, the same basic rights achieved by American workers over 100 years ago to migrant workers who are being unjustly exploited and forced to work more than 8 hours per day to obtain the same necessities required to live a dignified life. Popular media convinces us that because they are undocumented, they don't have access to basic human rights, they don't have access to the Affordable Care Act. But aren't we all descendants of immigrants, except for the original inhabitants, the Native American Yakima Nation? By dehumanizing migrant workers that are forced to move to the U.S. due to U.S. policies, we dehumanize ourselves. The time has come for our government to put an end to actions that violate human rights and are an affront to human dignity. We need to help make this message clear to everyone and empower not only the migrant working class, but also the American working class. United, we are powerful, and only united can we fight for our human rights. In Cuba, I learned that healthcare is a human right. In the US, mind-body medicine is an alternative movement that's not emphasized, whereas in Cuba, it is integrated into medical education. I didn't just graduate as a medical doctor, but I also learned to promote conscientiousness and unity in the midst of blatant injustice. At ELAM, we learned to truly live and study with students from all over the world. We learned international solidarity with our colleagues and friends, and of course, our Cuban adoptive families. We learn about the international struggles, including from Palestine and the Sahrawi Arab Democratic Republic, African and Latin American countries devastated by a long history of our government's imperialist war efforts. I tell everybody that I learned more about my country after 6 years in Cuba than my entire life before that here. There are many people that helped me in my life, but I am forever grateful to Reverend Lucius Walker, founder of IFCO, who has fought, starved, and risked his life for hundreds of American students to become the doctors we are today. His dream was for us to come back and serve our underserved communities with humanitarian-based medicine, and I am determined to fulfill this dream that is now my dream as well. Thank you for your support.
Thank you so much. I'm Valentina Warner. I'm a family practice doctor. I work at Rainier Beach Medical Clinic in Rainier Valley, and I've been working there for 17 years. And when I first started working there, it was 1998, and there were pretty good, we gave excellent care. And people would say, oh, that's so nice, you work at a community clinic, like it was some kind of sacrifice on my part. And I always felt kind of guilty, like, oh, you know, it's actually pretty not too hard of a job, you know, because we had really excellent resources. We had one nurse for every person, for every provider. We had so much extra resources for in terms of social work and home visits. The nurses, after a person had a baby, would go to their house. And it was a really, you know, gratifying place that I felt like in some ways my patients got better care than probably if they went to a private practice, because we had all these really generous services. And then in the early 2000s, there started to be a lot of cutbacks and austerity, with cutbacks to various things in terms of DSHS compensation to specialists went down a lot, so our patients couldn't get specialist care near as easily. Our social workers got cut. Our home visits for newborns got cut. Housing benefits got cut. So we had to, you know, I routinely, if a woman is homeless and has a baby, she gets sent home to a homeless shelter, which is not a home. You know, the productivity has gotten much more intense. We have to see patients in about 10 minutes per patient, and that's with an interpreter when they have incredible social difficulties. And in addition, the whole infrastructure of the whole healthcare system is falling apart. So, like, even if you have commercial insurance and you go to a place called Minor and James, which is a, you know, middle-class specialty clinic, in Seattle, like, they don't even answer the phone now. I mean, no, I cannot get anybody that knows what's going on to answer the phone and answer my questions, get records. It's incredibly frustrating, and it's not just a poor person's problem anymore. It used to be a poor person's problem, but now it's universal in the whole healthcare system. I can tell you a story about one part of our healthcare system that's just evil and why it shouldn't be for profit. I have a patient who was in her early 30s. She'd been my patient since she was 16, and she came in for a sports physical, and she was pregnant. And so I've had a long relationship with her, but she never really came into the doctor much because she's just one of those kind of people who didn't go to the doctor very much. But in addition, she had, you know, not great benefits, but she had insurance. And so she came in one day, and she was extremely depressed, which I was not typical of her to have any emotional problems. She was just a really kind of hardworking, kind of rock-like person. And her mother had died. Her mother had had substance abuse problems, and so she had, you know, in medicine what we call a complicated grief reaction, really got very depressed, and because it caused all these ripple effects in her whole family, of course, and her she became estranged from her sister, who was her best friend, and it was starting to affect her ability to function. And I'm pretty slow to prescribe antidepressants because I usually, you know, try to get people to take better care of themselves and understand how depression works and how you can take better care of yourself and oftentimes improve your depression if you take some steps like start exercising and doing positive things. And so, but she was really worrying me. And so I did start her on antidepressants, and I've started on Celexa, citalopram is the generic name, and it's $4 at Walmart. I tend to only prescribe things that are like about, you know, that are super cheap like that, because I know that my patients are often have difficulty getting their medications with prior authorizations, et cetera. So I always prescribe on the on that list unless I have no other option. So I prescribed her this medicine knowing it would be really inexpensive. And she went to, I believe it was Rite Aid, and they charged her $97. And I didn't know that. She picked up the medication. She makes probably, I guess, you know, $12 an hour, and she has two kids. So that must have been an incredible hardship. But because she had so much faith in me as a provider, she said, I'm going to do this because she said I should. And so then she called back a couple of days later and said, oh, I had a rash. And then she told us a story about the medication. And I got so upset, and I called the pharmacy to find out what happened and to demand a refund for that money for her. And the pharmacist said, oh, it's because she has a high deductible. And so basically they charge, so, and I said, how much would it have been without insurance? And she said it would have been $9 or $7 or something like that. So basically it was like a racket between the insurance company and the pharmaceutical company to charge her $97. And the pharmacist acted like it was just the most reasonable thing in the world. And I, you know, I got really upset, and I actually told her, I will come out there with a picket sign after work today if you do not refund her money. So they refunded her money. They said they would have done it anyway. I'm like, right. But anyway, so, you know, unfortunately, so she didn't want to take that medicine anymore, of course, because she got the rash. And I explained to the patient, you know, that she could go back and get a refund. And then I called her a few days later to check in on her and make sure that she did get her refund, because I wanted to, I was actually hoping she wouldn't so I could actually do a picket line. That would have been fun. And so anyway, but because this stuff happens all the time and they get away with it and they get caught and they're like, oh, sorry, we didn't mean to. So anyway, she got her money back. And then, you know, I talked to her and she actually said she started to feel better because she just, you know, needed to grieve and vent and, you know, and have somebody care about her. And that was what I was able to do for her. And she didn't need to be on antidepressants. And I called her again and she was feeling pretty good. So that's just one example of gangsterism in American medical system. So that is such an extreme but common example. It's like, how can you even compare the free medical care you get in Cuba? I mean, this is gangsterism. There's no other way to describe that. What do you have to say? Do you think that's good?
Well, I completely agree with you. I think it's a form of terrorism, actually, against our own people. And we have so much to learn from the Cuban healthcare system. You know, Cuba receives a lot of critiques from our government, but I think that we certainly can try to model our healthcare system after them. You know, I just learned so much. I learned that in Cuba, healthcare is really a right. It's a human right. And we always talk about democracy and, you know, spreading democracy all over the world, but it's, we don't even spread democracy in our own country. And healthcare is definitely something that needs a lot of help, and a lot of people are suffering. So I just don't know when it's, what it's going to take for Americans to realize that we need to change as soon as possible.
The whole plan of having the school to train doctors to mm-hmm. send them to the richest country in the world. What do people not get about that?
Well, you have to have in mind that although the U.S. is a first world country, you have third world pockets where people have the same health statistics as you would have in a third world country. So the original idea that was offered by Fidel was to train Americans from underserved communities to come back to those underserved communities and help, apply sort of the Cuban healthcare model and provide a more humanitarian form of healthcare. That was the original idea. And they've trained over 200 American students. So we have 200 doctors that are either in the process of being licensed or have already entered residency programs. So we're having a good success rate. Yeah.
And could you explain again, why, you're coming from a poor family, but, you've made it to be a doctor. But you have all these obstacles, in your way. You have to pay all this money just to take a test.
Yeah.
Explain a little bit more about that.
Yeah. The U.S. is, I think, maybe the hardest country to revalidate our title coming from the Cuban Elan program. Because we have to come back and pay for these exams and pay for courses that prepare us for exams, and that's certainly an obstacle for us coming back and working legally in these underserved communities. So a lot of students have that as a barrier, depending on their economic situation. But most of us are from underserved communities and have that obstacle. There are scholarships available, but they can't really fund the whole process. So it certainly helps to have community funding or people that support you to go through the process.
Okay. All right, thanks.